तो हाय स्नेहल, हाउ आर यू?
यस सर, आई एम फाइन.
ओके, तो द एजेंडा इज टू यू नो कंडक्ट अ मॉक इंटरव्यू फॉर यू टुडे, एंड इट वुड बी अ मैनुअल टेस्टिंग क्वेश्चंस बेस्ड. ओके, सो कैन यू टेल मी समथिंग अबाउट योरसेल्फ?
यस सर, आई एम स्नेहल. I stay in Mumbai, Maharashtra. I completed MSc Computer Science from Patka College, Goregaon, which is at Mumbai. Then I have the 2 years of experience in teaching as a role of assistant professor. I was used to teach the programming languages to the ITCS students. And later on, I'm going to switch my career into the software testing. So that's why I'm looking opportunity in software testing.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, so
that's
can you
it
tell
about
me?
Me.
Yeah. Okay. So can you tell me something about you know, what is the difference between load testing and stress testing?
Okay, load testing and stress testing, these both are the types of non-functional testing. Here we check the stability and response time of an application by applying some load. It is called as the performance. So load testing and stress testing. In load testing, we check the stability and response time of an application by applying the load, which is the more than or equal to design number of users. And in the stress testing,
In load testing, is it more?
Which is less than or equal to design number of user.
Okay.
And in the stress testing, we test the system or the application by applying the load, which is more than the design number of user. Let's take the example. Suppose there is a software, and suppose I want to do the load testing, and the requirements is like that software is designed for 1,000 number of users. So for load testing, I will apply the load for 1,000 and less than 1,000. That is what the load testing. But in the stress testing, I will apply the load which is more than 1,000 design number of user. So it's a stress test. Stress testing.
Right. So in load testing, as you mentioned, we are testing for number of users that the website or that the application is going to work with. Let's say if the application is going to handle 1,000 users, so we will give the load of 10, 100, 150, and till 1,000 we would be doing the load testing. While for stress testing, we are testing beyond the limit, beyond the threshold limit. Okay, that is beyond the 1,000 users. Okay, so what is the difference between regression testing and retesting?
Regression testing means testing the unchanged feature of an application. If we make any add, delete, modify, or any bug fixes, then it should not impact my unchanged feature of an application. It's called as the regression testing. And the retesting is testing the failure component or the module. It's called as the retesting. Let's take the example. Suppose there is an application. On that application, there is a login module. So there is an options like I can log in by Gmail, by LinkedIn and by Facebook. Okay, while testing, suppose I got the defect in login by Gmail. So in regression testing, what I will do, I will I will raise the defect, give it to the developer, developer fix it. Now I will do the regression testing. In regression testing, I will test for that login for Gmail module functionality, as well as the login by LinkedIn and the Facebook also. It should not impact my other functionalities which are in my module. But in the retesting, let's take that same example. So first I will raise the defect, give it to the developer, developer fix it. Now I will do the retesting. I will do the retesting only for that login by Gmail functionality, not for the other functionalities. So that is what the retesting.
Yeah, correct. Okay, now let me share my screen. And once it is visible, are you able to see the screen? Just a second. Yeah, are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a microwave oven. Okay. Now, can you tell me the test cases for this microwave oven?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
First, I will verify the dimensions of that microwave oven. Then I will verify the color. Next, I will verify the text which is written over on that microphone. I will verify that. Mm-hmm. Then next, I will verify the if we switched on the that button, then I will check whether that light is blinking as a starting light is blinking or not. Then I will verify the if door is opening or closing properly or not, or is there any obstacles while opening or closing the door. Then next, I will set the temperature at the very high temperature and will verify with the low temperature. I will also verify the buttons which were used in that microphone. I will verify the buttons. Then I will verify the that touch screen button, whether that whatever text which is written over direct like degree, 20 degree, it is visible or not. Then I will verify the rods which is used in that microwave oven.
Okay. Any other scenarios that are coming up to your mind?
I will verify the power cable. If I plugged in, then oven is starting or not.
Right. Mm-hmm. The power that cable much. As per the different voltages, right?
Power.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. So let me show you the scenarios. Yeah. So see, this one you covered. Verify that the dimensions of the oven are as per the specification provided. Then the oven's material should be optimal for its use and as per the specifications, like as per the requirements, it should be there. Then verify that the oven heats the food at the desired temperature properly. Then verify the oven heats, oven's functions with the maximum attainable temperature and with the minimum attainable temperature. So both the limits we have to check. Then verify that the oven's plate rotation speed is optimal and it is not too high that the food gets spillover. Okay. Then verify the oven's door gets closed properly. Oven's door opens smoothly. So it should not be, you know, too much of a, you know, tight door that user is not able to close it. It should not be loose also that it goes and gets opened and closed. So based on the usability, you can do that kind of testing. Then verify that the battery requirement of the microwave oven and check that it functions smoothly at that power. Okay, so this, I think power cable related you had mentioned. Then text written is clearly readable. Whatever the documents pertaining to the microwave oven, that is the, you know, manual that you are getting, that should contain all the correct information. Then digital display manual. Then digital display should be clearly visible and functions correctly. Then temperature regulator is smooth to operate. Then temperature regulator works correctly, right? If you are increasing temperature by 1, 2, so it should increment as per that level only. Then check that the maximum capacity of the oven and test its functioning with that volume of food. Okay. Then check the oven's functionality with different food at different temperatures. Like you can keep, you know, milk, or you can keep other food items, and then you can check. Then verify the oven's functionality with different kinds of container material. Let's say if you are putting some different kind of container with options in container. So those all permutations and combinations you have to check. Then verify that the power cord of the oven is long enough. You know, it should not be so short that it starts at, you know, from the from the plug and then it gets over soon. So how will a user be able
length.
To use it? Then verify the user user manual has clear instructions. Okay. So this was just an example of one of the, you know, object. Similarly, you can get the, you know, the in an interview, they might ask you the questions on pen or paper or fan or any e-commerce website you can take. So so in interviews, yes. They expect you to bring out the high level scenarios of the objects that you see on the screen. Okay. It is not necessary that you write each and every test case. What is the actual result? What is the expected result? But you have to mention in this manner. Okay. Now, are you able to see the next slide?
Yes.
Okay. So this is a MCQ type of question. Now, impact analysis, you might be aware about. So it helps us to decide. You have to choose any one of the option. How much regression testing should be done? What is exit criteria, or how many more test cases need to be written, or different tools to perform regression testing. So any one of the option is correct. And you have to choose any one of the
option to be written.
Yeah, which option?
Option C.
Option C. How many more test cases need to be written?
Actually,
Mm-hmm. Hello. Hello, Snehal, you are on mute.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, which option you choose?
Actually, sir, I am confused between, actually, I am confused between A and C, but
okay. Okay,
I
no
think
problem.
C.
You feel C is the right answer?
With option.
Okay, let me help you with the answer. Okay, see, A is the right answer. How much regression testing should be done? See, impact analysis is what? As I asked you, you know, a question on regression testing and retesting. So impact analysis
yes.
would, yeah. So impact analysis would come mm-hmm. into the picture when actually you have to decide that the certain piece of code that has been fixed by the developer, how much is it going to impact my testing? Do I need to test the whole application, or how much areas do I need to test? So in that case, you will be coming across, you know, it would help you to decide the level of regression testing, or how much regression testing you have to perform. Okay. Is it clear? Okay. Okay, now peer reviews are also called as, is it inspection, walkthrough, technical review, or formal review? Snehal, I think you are again on mute.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Technical review.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's the right answer. So, see, you are getting tensed, but you should be confident. You are knowing the right answers, but still, if you get tensed, you'll get nervous. Then, you know, you'll start answering wrongly in the interviews. Right? So, be confident. Don't be nervous. This is your domain. This is your area of expertise. So, and be confident. That would help you to, clear the interview actually. Okay. Now you might would have heard about the testing techniques, right? Mm-hmm. Boundary value analysis is there, or equivalence partitioning is there. Right, Snehal?
Partition. Yes, sir.
Okay. So in that, you know, here are the four equivalence classes given. Now the requirement is that there is a field in a form which contains a text box. Snehal? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there is a field on a form that contains a text box and it should accept alphabets in lower or uppercase. Okay, this is the requirement. Simple, straight. Is the requirement clear to you? Okay. Now you have to identify.
Yes.
Yeah. Now you have to identify the invalid equivalence class value. So which one do you feel is the invalid?
Class D.
The last one? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, which one is the right answer? I think there is some network issue.
Last one, yes, sir.
Okay.
Last option.
Yeah, last option is the right answer. Okay. Now you have to tell me the test scenarios for video viewing on YouTube. Let's say you are going on a, you know, you are looking at the videos on YouTube. So what all test scenarios will come across? What all things that you will be testing for videos that are uploaded on YouTube?
Video viewing.
Your voice is breaking. Can you turn off your video? I think that might help you to, you know, gain bandwidth. You can keep the audio on for the time being. Hello.
Okay. Yeah. First, I will verify the that YouTube is working on the particular browsers or not. Like in Google Chrome, it's opening or not. In other browsers like Firefox, Internet Explorer. Then second one, I will verify by seeing the setting like default theater mode, full screen. Then third one is the I will verify the quality, like 144, 240, 360. I will verify that quality with HD also.
Mm-hmm.
I will verify the audio as well as the video. Then I will verify the views that are increasing or not. I will verify if I press on the liked button, then it should be gold. Like it should change the color to green. I will dislike the video and then check the count, it's working or not. I will verify the whether the video is downloadable or not.
Okay. Any other scenarios that is coming to your mind?
I will verify while I minimize the browser, then still video is running or not.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let me help you with the test scenarios. See, verify the video page can be opened by a direct link to a video. Let's say if someone gives you a link of that YouTube video, so you'll click on that link and you'll see whether the respective video is opening or not. Then verify that on clicking the video play icon over the video, the video should play. Okay, so that is very basic test cases. Then verify that all the video player controls like play, pause, volume, mute, those all should work. Then you mentioned about this video quality of playing the video. Then we also have got an option of replay icon. Then verify the video should be searchable by name. Let's say if you are searching the videos on Mumbai, Maharashtra, so those videos should come up first. If you are searching for Kerala, then those videos should come. Then verify that the other attributes of the video like artist name, description should also be searchable. Verify that user should get auto suggestions while searching for videos in the YouTube search bar. Let's say if you are watching video pertaining to the COVID news, then in the auto search bar, all the news related or the corona related new videos should start coming up, right? So auto suggestions should work. Then verify search results should display information like video name, thumbnail, video length, view counts. So whenever you are searching any particular video on YouTube, so you should get all this information, okay? Then verify that clicking the video thumbnails in the search results should lead to the video page. Let's say if you have searched the video pertaining to the IPL cricket, and if you are clicking on that thumbnail, so your video should get played from that clicking on the thumbnail. Then video filtering and sorting option should work, like how many view counts has been received to the video or what is the uploaded date. If you want to watch the videos of the last 24 hours, so those sorting should work. Then verify user can view count, comments, like and dislikes for a video until unless the subscribers and all those things also you should be visible until unless it is made hidden from the YouTuber itself. Then verify that with each view, the view count increases by one. Let's say now, for example, the XYZ video has got 100 views. Now you go and watch the video and then again you go and watch. So it should increment by one because you have already seen it once. Then verify user can comment in the comment section, and then all the comments, that is, you should be able to put the comment in the form of alphanumeric tag, then alphabetic special characters with space, with white space characters. So comments kind of testing should be done. Then verify the user should be presented with related videos in the sidebar section. This I think is covered earlier. Verify that the related videos are related to the current video or is based on the past viewing history of the user. So this is how, you know, YouTube algorithm works. If you have already watched some of the videos, so they will recommend based on your search itself.
Yes.
Then age restricted video should be, you know, asking you to signing up into your YouTube account. Then I think this is video related thumbnail should open the video. Logged in user should see the history as well as the recommend videos in the home page. Verify that every video viewed goes to the history for logged in user. User can view or delete history items. Okay. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, which are the various components in test cases?
In test cases, test case ID, test case name, description, then test data, actual output, expected output, comments, bug ID.
Okay. And there is also prerequisite or precondition, right? And
yes, preconditions, yes.
Right? Okay. Apart from that, all the components has been covered. Okay. Now, which are the various phases of STLC, software testing lifecycle?
Software testing lifecycle, it is a part of SDLC, software development lifecycle. STLC, we use to test any new software. First is the requirement planning. Then second one is the test plan, test design and development, test case environment setup, then test or execution, test or reports, and last one is the test closure. So these are the steps which is involved in the STLC.
In the STLC, perfect. Okay. Now, what is a bug life cycle? Which are the different states that you will get in the bugs, for the bugs?
If any feature or functionality is missing and it's not working as per the user requirement, then it is called as the defect. Or you can say the variation between the actual output and expected output is called as the defect. The defect life cycle, which consists of the following steps, like first one is the new or the open. Then second one is the assign. Third one is the fix. Fourth, next one is the retest. And last one is the close.
Okay.
So these are the steps.
Okay. Now after assign, there might be also one state that is of default.
Hmm.
Let's say if the defect is there. Okay. So when the default state would come into the picture is when it is rejected by the developer. Okay, it is not as per the requirement. As per the requirement, if it is working fine, then those defects would be rejected or deferred by the developer. Also, there is one more state of duplicate. Duplicate means, let's say as a tester, if you have already logged that defect.
Duplicate, yes, I know that.
Then that state would come. Then after, it is fixed, then retested would come. But again, there are chances that the defect might get reopened. It might not work for some scenario, or it might not work for the same scenario. Then you have to reject it.
And so that is raised by the another.
Yeah. So that would be rejected. Okay. So these are two or three states that you can add in the defect life cycle. Okay, Snehal. Okay. So I am done with the interview, Snehal. Do you have any questions for me?
Okay. No, sir, I don't have any question. But I want to get to know, sir, as a fresher, on which topic I should focus more?
Mm-hmm. See, as a fresher, if you are going for any interview, so they'll give you, they'll ask you the differences between these various types of testing, like difference between smoke and sanity testing.
Sanity.
Unit and integration testing. What is the difference between severity and priority? Examples of high severity, low priority, and low severity, high priority. These two things you have to cover. Then the difference between unit testing and integration testing, and V&V model of STLC that they can ask. Then they can ask you the questions on agile methodology, like what is user story, what is sprint, what is velocity. Because in most of the companies now, agile methodology is getting followed. So they might ask you those questions.
Yes, sir.
Then they might ask you the questions on testing techniques, like we had covered in the MCQ form, like which are the invalid or the valid equivalence class. So those questions might come to you. Again, questions on boundary value analysis, decision coverage, statement coverage, those questions can come to you. Now, if
design techniques.
Yeah. Now, if the job description includes something, keywords like automation, Selenium is required, Selenium with Java is required, then they'll ask you the questions on automation. And if you are having good knowledge on automation, then there are more chances for you to get selected. So apart from, sometimes investing in the manual testing, and as you are teaching also. So apart from that, daily take out some 30 minutes to 45 minutes for doing practice on Selenium. You can take any website, like Amazon.com is there, Flipkart.com is there. You'll get all types of controls. You'll get text box, you'll get drop down, you'll get text to be verified, combo box is there, list is there, unordered list, ordered list. All these kind of control you should try to automate using Selenium by yourself. You can search first, how is it working? You'll get many videos on the YouTube. Then you try to practice by yourself how you are able, whether you are able to do the implement in that manner or not. Okay. So you'll come to know about Selenium, and within 2 or 3 months, you'll be having a good knowledge on Selenium as well, because now you have understood the theoretical and understood the same Selenium concepts from practical point of view. Generally, if we watch the videos, then we are not able to, retain what we have learned for much longer time. But if you have practiced it
and implement,
then there you go. You will be able to remember the things, and you will be able to answer also. So see, now these days, after COVID and all those things, automation has gone to a different stage. Every company would be demanding the automation skills. If not in the first 6 months, they'll ask you to get it by the in the next 6 months. They'll be expecting that, okay, now she might be, you know, she should be able to do so and so automation. At least she should be able to do one or two test cases. If it's a very complex application, you should be able to build one or two test cases, right? So those things you should try to learn. Don't limit yourself only to the manual.
Definitely.
Okay.
Yes, sir.